and to the analysis of Shields and Douthat, Syndicated columnist Mark Shields, New York Times columnist Ross Douthat. David Brooks is away tonight. Mark, where do today's or the recent economic numbers fit into what passes for government and politics in Washington right now?
Well, I think it was a psychological lift. I don't think it was an economic breakthrough, but at a time of relentlessly bad news, the fact that it was not negative made it very positive.
You're talking about the job
today's
numbers,
jobs,
but what about
yeah.
the stock market?
The stock market is sobering, to say the least.
Yeah.
Anybody that's figured out that stock market to me has just been what do people think is going to happen on the economy, and generally speaking, people think the economy is bad, and they're not optimistic about the future.
Ross, do you agree with what was said in the earlier discussion that the government doesn't have any silver bullets left to do anything about this thing right now, the economic thing?
I think in the short term that's definitely true. I think that given the political correlation of forces, there's just a real limit on what the White House can push for. And I think everything that was talked about earlier, from the payroll tax cut extension, unemployment benefits, and so on, is really just incredibly small given what I think we understand to be the scope of the problem, which is why it seems very likely that we will, in fact, get yet another round of quantitative easing from the Fed at some point in the next few months.
You agree with what the man from S&P told Jeff, that some of the influence on the stock market, at least, was the terrible debate and process that got between the president and the Congress that ended in this debt bill, legislation, let's call it.
Actually, my sense is that yesterday's stock market numbers are more a sign that actually Washington isn't necessarily the center of the economic universe, and that there was what we saw was sort of a sigh of modest relief from Wall Street following the deal on the debt ceiling, and then everybody turned their attention to Europe and sort of threw up their hands and said, "Oh wait, Europe's going down the tubes." So I'm skeptical that the big sell-off had that much to do with Washington politics. I think it had much more to do with politics in Italy, Brussels, and everywhere in between.
You see it the same way, Mark?
I honestly don't know, Jim. Yeah. I do think politically, in answer to your question about what the administration has to do, I mean, that's the ball game for them in 2012 is jobs. And anything else, a diversion, whether it's debt ceiling, whatever it is, it has to be jobs. And I think they have to think beyond their comfort zone, whether it is an infrastructure bank, a national infrastructure bank, a major effort, whether it's contractors have to buy America unless they have an exception. I mean, I think that there's a number of things you can do. You have to extend unemployment benefits. You've got to keep the demand at some level, and plus to ease the pain that people are going through. I just think that's where the 2012 election is going to be fought. It's not going to be fought on deficits. Mm-hmm. I mean,
but don't you think, Mark, that there's a danger for the president? Everybody talks about making the pivot to jobs, right? But if you make the pivot to jobs and spend all of your time talking about jobs, and the jobs don't materialize. I mean, this has been the position the White House has been in a sense, for the past year. You know, you had the recovery summer. You know, they've sort of kept trying to rhetorically pivot to jobs without having, as we said, a bullet in the chamber to do anything about it.
Well, I think that they have to offer initiatives that puts the Republicans on the defensive. I mean, if the Republicans want to oppose, whether it's jobs programs or an infrastructure bank, I think they put too much confidence, quite honestly, in the free trade agreements with Korea and Colombia, because Bill McIntyre, the Republican pollster, the preeminent Republican pollster, said Americans have lost confidence, including Republicans,
right,
in free trade agreements.
And that's been
true
for some time.
They see that the United States gets rolled, and that it becomes a proxy for outsourcing jobs and shipping them overseas.
Do you agree with Mark, Ross, that 2012 is going to be about this issue of what the government can do or not do? Is it about deficits, or is it about getting jobs through government programs or government action?
I think it's going to be much. How many muches can I add? More about jobs than about deficits, especially since there's now been at least some kind of a partial, quasi sort of deal that the White House can point to on the deficit. And I think it's going to be a debate about who do you blame for the current economic situation, Barack Obama or George W. Bush? And I think ultimately the Obama White House is going to be stuck running a fairly negative campaign, basically arguing that whoever the Republican nominee is, whether it's Mitt Romney, Rick Perry, or somebody else, they're just a continuation of the Bush administration. And if you look at the polls, more Americans still blame Bush for the current economic woes than blame Obama. And I think that's going to be the focus of the White House's strategy.
How does that fit into the new poll, yesterday's poll that was out today, CBS New York Times poll, about the low, low opinion that the American people have of the Congress?
Well, you know, the Congress, as somebody once said, serves two distinct purposes. It makes the United Nations look efficient, by contrast, and it makes the president's job rating look good. But we've been through three straight elections in a row, Jim, that have repealed one of the great maxims of American politics: all politics is local. Mm-hmm. All politics is not local. It is local until it's national. And we've gone through three national elections where they've thrown the ins out. I mean, 2006, it was the Republicans, and 2008, and 2010, it was the Democrats. And I think what you see in that New York Times poll is an electorate ready to throw people out again.
And you could end up with a Democratic House and a Republican president.
I suggested that to Peter Hart today, that there was a possibility.
What did he say?
He said that would be really exceptional.
It would be exceptional.
But given the distemper of voters, I mean, they are so angry. If you saw the words that they attached in Andy Kohut's poll after the deal on the debt ceiling, I mean, they were ridiculous, offensive, outrageous, childish, stupid. Those were the words that the voters just volunteered.
Well, do you think this is going to change anything? In other words, the polls and the press reaction and the overall public reaction to how Congress has conducted itself this last several months, is the Congress going to change in any way, do you think?
I doubt it. I mean, I think that one of the new truths of American politics is that presidential elections they create a kind of overhang that goes back months and months and months. And I think basically we have a sort of a small window here where the super committee meets and we try and figure out if there's actually going to be another phase of deficit reduction. And then after that, it's just going to be all presidential politics all the time. And I think that will push both parties. It'll give Republicans a disincentive. I mean, they already have a disincentive to work with the White House, but it'll give them an even greater disincentive. And it'll give the White House an incentive to run against John Boehner and Mitch McConnell. I think what Mark was saying is true. If Barack Obama could run for president against the congressional Republicans in 2012, he would stand a pretty good chance of winning. His problem is that he'll be running against somebody else.
And every incumbent president who seeks re-election, the election is by definition a referendum on that incumbent president. And Ross's point is that the White House's strategy will be to say, look, you know,
why not?
We don't have a particular litany of achievements and successes we can point to, but this other fella, he didn't return his library books. He didn't use the revolving door. He talked to the bus driver while the bus was in motion. He violated every rule and probably didn't take a breathalyzer test when he was 18 years old. I mean,
But Mark, if you're right that the people are angry and they're upset at everybody, and it continues. I mean, the people for the targets of this anger just continue to operate the same way they've been operating. Now, this can't go on for another year, can it?
No. What you have to have is a sense at some point that somebody is competent at a position of leadership. That Barack Obama is in a position right now not unlike that of Bill Clinton in 1995. Bill Clinton emerged from his showdown with the Republicans, Congress, then elevated as the dominant figure. I don't think Barack Obama emerges from his confrontation with the Republican Congress, the Republican House anyway, not as an enhanced figure. He looks stronger by contrast.
By contrast,
yes.
Right. And this is the core weakness of the Obama presidency right now, which is that even if he emerges, you know, in slightly better shape than the congressional Republicans from these debates, the overall impression that the public is getting is of presidential weakness, an inability to manage Washington. I mean, the whole theory of the Obama campaign in 2008 was, vote for me, I'm going to change Washington, I'm going to make it work again, all the rest of it. And, you know, for the average voter who doesn't follow politics that closely, they look at the situation in Washington and they think, well, maybe we should put somebody else in charge of it.
The one thing we've not talked about is the FAA thing that kind of fell between the cracks when everybody was worrying about the debt ceiling debate. That was a terrible thing, wasn't it?
It was a terrible thing.
I mean, and now it's over. They made a deal, and they
passed they made a deal in September. It's not a peace treaty.
No, I shouldn't say that was talking.
Yeah,
I should let you say that, Mark.
No, but
it gets
you a pass to September.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I mean, walking out of town.
How do things like that happen?
Walking out of town. Well, what happens is you get jurisdictional fights between House and Senate, and between individuals and vanity, and you get a question of swagger and power, and I'm going to show them. And the idea of doing this and then leaving town, as the Republican House did in particular, but the Senate was ready to do it as well, and leaving 87,000 people without jobs, and for the FAA, 4,000 people whose responsibility is airline safety, and then you find out that we're subsidizing passengers in airports to $1,000 a ticket. I mean, Pennsylvania, its entire air service appears to be subsidized by the federal government.
Did something like that happen, Ross? Explain that, please.
Well, part of it is, and this is sort of an interesting thing that's become clear since the last election. When people think about divided government, we usually think about the way it was in the 1990s, right, where Republicans controlled the House mm-hmm. and Senate, Democrats controlled the White House, and so on. But part of what's driving dysfunction right now is that it is, as Mark says, it's fighting between the House and the Senate. And so the House is in Republican hands, and they keep passing legislation that mm-hmm. you know, Democratic senators say, well, that's too right-wing, or it has a poison
dead
pill in
arrival.
It, and so
dead
on.
Arrival.
Dead on arrival.
Right.
Then the Senate, of course, it's been an extensive amount of time since the Senate last successfully passed a budget and so on. But so you have this House and Senate back and forth that the White House isn't even part of. And that's part of what happened with the FAA is it wasn't, you know, it was one House in one party's hands, the other House in the other party's hands.
And it's the House did something that was really rather remarkable. In order, as somebody who believes fervently in the right of workers to collectively bargain for their terms of employment, the election, in other words, whether we're going to be represented by a union or not, they changed the rule that simply a majority of us voting, if there's 50 of us voting, and there's 75 of us who are members of this group, and 29 of us vote for it, then we become part of this union. The Republicans said, no, you have to get an absolute majority of all the eligible people. That's what they passed, which really, quite frankly, is anti-democratic in the sense of...
You have a view of that, Ross?
I mean, I think that there's an issue here that comes up again and again between the role of unions in the private sector and the role of unions in the public sector and so on. And I think that there's an argument to be made on the Republican side on that front that you're dealing with a different kind of situation there from...
You can argue that, but you can't argue
I mean,
majority.
If the whole...
You can't argue... I mean, a majority of those voting is...
Well, but then you get in a situation where, you know, 10 people vote and you suddenly have a union because...
Well, you know, you have to have a quorum.
Well, this has really been interesting, this exchange that you all have had about this, and we're going to end it now and go back to... No, we're going to leave it now. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Ross,
Jim.
Good to see you again. Mark?
Thank you, Jim.